All right, let's get started. Thank you for coming to the session. As you might have heard, we have announced the first developer preview of Couchbase Analytics at this conference. And today, Yingyi Bu and I will give you a sneak preview at the system, what we're shipping, what we want to, what the vision is, and what it actually is. So actually, that's kind of already getting into the agenda. So first, we'll have a short overview over the vision of Couchbase Analytics. Then we will talk a little bit about how to use it, so give some examples of uses of the product. Then we'll talk a little bit about what actually, so what is new in here, what's technically new in here. Then we'll explain what actually you will get with a developer preview that you can download. And finally, we'll have a short demo of, so yeah, that you can see in real life what's happening. All right. So what is Couchbase Analytics? So Couchbase Analytics is, as you have heard before, I think, another service in the sense of the Couchbase multidimensional scaling that supports a number of other services. And the idea of this new service is to extend the Couchbase data platform with support to run real-time analytics. And so a few of the properties that we wanted to have in that when we thought about this, the first requirement really is that we want to be able to run ad hoc analytics. So basically, we want to be able to run, to ask any question of the data that we have that we would want to ask. And so there's one important aspect there, of course, just the expressiveness of the language. So we have a fully expressible, fully, composable language. And but there's another interesting aspect. So when you allow such powerful queries and you allow to run them and you allow to ask anything, some of those questions might be pretty expensive. And so because that cost is sometimes prohibitive to run on a regular Couchbase cluster, if you use Couchbase today, you probably have a transaction-heavy workload, so you really are interested that a high number of transactions per second go into that system. And so if you would just now run a very expensive query on such a cluster, and you would take up the resources to process that query, then you would kind of bring down the performance of your ingestion. And so therefore, the other important aspect is the workload isolation. So we wanted to have a workload-isolated way of running our transaction workload and running our analytics workload in parallel without interfering. And another thing that kind of goes with that is that, of course, we want to also independently scale those two things, because you might have different requirements on both, on your expected response times for analytics, on your expected response times or key throughput for your operations. And so therefore, we want to be able to scale those two independently, because both of them, yeah, you should be in control of the resources that you need for those. Another thing that we really want to have is a common programming and data model for all the services that we have. And specifically, this is really about the query service, because as you know, we already have one query service that allows you to query your data. And now we're adding another one that also allows you to query your data, the analytics query service. And obviously, you probably don't want to learn different ways of dealing with that. And so one of our other goals here is to have the same common programming and data model. So the data model is easy, because we're always talking about JSON. And for the coming programming model, we'll talk about that a little bit later. Another goal that we have, obviously, is that it should have unified management, so it should be a part of the Couchbase platform and integrated and scaled like just like all the other MDS services, and be able to be managed the same way and just be a full citizen of that platform. And another very important aspect here is that we want to have that we want to have really fast synchronization. So the idea here is that the data that you get into your database, into Couchbase Server, into your data nodes, should be available for querying, for analytic querying immediately. So we really want to reduce the turnaround time between an analysis and getting the result, or basically an update to the data and getting the result, to allow much faster time to insight than you have today. Today, if you run analyses on Couchbase data, what usually happens is that you take the data out of Couchbase, move it into another system, do an analysis, potentially feed the data back into Couchbase to be able to use it in an application. And this turnaround loop is pretty long. And one of the important goals that we have is to significantly shorten that so that we can immediately get that information that was just updated into the analytics, run an analysis, and be able to serve that to the application. All right. So that is the vision. And soon we'll talk about the reality. Okay, so first, how do we use it? So the language with which we talk to this service is called C++. And it's that was initially developed at UCSD. And right after this talk, there will be another talk by Yannis Papakonstantinou, who developed this language at UCSD. And here we'll give a few examples of that so that you get a flavor of what it looks like and how comfortable you're with it. And then in the next talk, you can get some more details if you're interested in those. So let's get started with a very simple example. So as the previous talk, we also talk about the beer sample, of course, because we're at Couchbase and the beer sample is always there, so that's very nice. So in the beer sample, we have the beer bucket. In the beer bucket, we have two kinds of documents that you can see here. One example, you have beer documents and you have brewery documents. And on the left side, you see a beer document, and that has a name. It has a percentage of the alcohol by volume, then some other numbers that are maybe not initialized. The type is beer. You get an ID for the brewery that actually makes this beer, and some other metadata with the description and the style. And for the breweries, you know where they are and what they are called and where they're from and get a phone number. Yeah, those are basically the kinds of data that you have in this data set, and that will be the basis of the queries that we'll be looking at right now. All right, so this is a very simple query. It is, give me three beers with the breweries. And if you look at this, what it does, it's probably, if you're familiar with SQL, life is good. This is kind of what it looks like. So you're selecting the brewery name and the beer name from the breweries and the beers. And that's basically then a join. You join that on the brewery ID with the meta.id. And if you're familiar with Couchbase or with Nickel, then you know that this is the way to address the key of this object in the key value store. So basically, we're doing a key join here, and then we order that by brewery name and by brewery name and beer. Yes, that's okay, fine. And then we just do a limit three so that the result fits on the slide. And but this is all standard SQL, right? I mean, if you would have written this in SQL without the meta function, it would be exactly the same, and the language is just the same. All right, let's get to the next example. So now we do something that is a little different. So this is a non-key self-join, and the interesting part here is that this shows you one thing that you can do with the analytics version of SQL++ that you cannot do with Nickel currently. So Nickel currently only allows you to join on keys, and it does that for a very good reason. The reason is that it is really optimized for operational use cases, for quick queries that address a small amount of data, because basically they run, the Nickel queries, the query service runs on the data nodes. And we just said, you know, if you have run expensive queries on the data nodes, that's a pretty bad idea. And so basically there's some limitation in there that keeps you from hurting yourself. And so this limitation is not necessary anymore on the analytics service. And therefore you can run such a join that basically joins on arbitrary things. And as you can see here, we're getting the beer. Okay, did I say what it is? It's getting three beer names used by different breweries. And so what we get here is so the name of the beer and the two breweries that provide that beer. And this is a self-join between the beers table where we basically make sure that where the filter is that both beers have the same name and the breweries have different names or different IDs. And you see there are actually a few of those, and okay, they all seem to be Scottish ale, and that's probably because I ordered by the brewery ID. So it's all the same brewery. All right. One more. So this now basically we're getting to a point that you wouldn't see in standard SQL because the result here actually is some nested data. So what we want to get now is we want for two breweries, we want to get the breweries and the beers, but this time the beers are actually nested in the result. So basically, in the result, we construct an array for each beer. For each brewery, you construct an array of beers that can be nested in that. And if you look at the query, it's all relatively simple. What you do is you select the brewer, and then you have a short subquery that takes the beers for this brewer and puts that as an array into your result. And that's basically it. So basically, what you're getting is you're getting a join that is this nested query will be translated into a join, and then you can efficiently evaluate such a query. Is the sound going away if I move over here? No? It just feels like... Okay. Okay. And then we have one more here. This kind of query is the bottom of the food pyramid for all analytics, I think. This is a simple grouping and aggregation. That's kind of the core of whatever you do, usually when you analyze things. So this is very simple. It gets all the breweries that produce more than 37 beers. And of course, the number 37 is carefully chosen to return three results. So that's the semantical meaning of this. What it does is, it gets the brewery ID, it gets the count of the beers from that beers table, groups by the brewery ID, because we want to have the beers per brewery, and just has the having clause to make sure that we get basically three results. All right, so this is kind of, you look at these queries, and if you know SQL++, if you know SQL, then you realize that SQL++ is very, very similar. If you know Nickel, it's also very similar, right? I mean, but all of those queries basically look the same as they are Nickel. So you see that basically, even though SQL++ and Nickel are not the same language, they are very, very close. And we are aiming to get them to be identical by the time we actually have a GA. So far, we have the first developer preview. And we're working on getting those identical so that we can achieve our goal of having the same interface for all services that we have in the platform. And of course, one of the reasons why they are so similar is that they come from a common heritage. They are both basically derived from SQL by removing restrictions from the query language from SQL to actually get to another SQL-like query language that allows you to use nested data. So far, what we had is were all those queries. And now, of course, the question is, okay, so you run a query, how did you actually get the data into this? And we said, we have this additional new service. How does this additional new service get the data in? And so to do this, we have an extension for what we call our shadow data set. So basically, what you do is, with these statements, the four statements that you see here basically will create two shadow data sets for us. The first one is a create bucket statement. And what the create bucket statement does is it actually creates a proxy for a bucket that exists on a data node for the analytic service. So basically, we're kind of declaring for the analytic service that there is a bucket on that data node that contains the data that we're looking at. And then basically, we can use this declaration of a bucket to actually create data sets for the analytic service. And we call those data sets shadow data sets. And that basically is another word for replication, but we didn't want to use replication because a replica we use for high availability, and we didn't want to mix those words up, so that's why they are called shadow data sets. And when you create a shadow data set, like the beers data set here, you create that data set on a beer bucket, and then you can provide a filter. And the filter in this case is that for the first one is that the type is beer, so we will have one data set that contains the beers, and then we will have another data set that will contain the breweries. So now, basically, after this, you have created two data sets that are that should contain the beers and the breweries. And finally, then you can use the connect statement to actually connect this bucket to Couchbase Server, to the data nodes, and then replication will start. And then basically, from that point on, all changes, you'll first get all the data that's already in there, and then all further changes will be continuously replicated to the system so that basically you will be able to immediately query the data that's in there. And yes. Okay, so once you've done this and you've replicated everything, so now basically in the complete life cycle, you can run a query. And so in this case, we're selecting star from the beers, order by the alcohol by volume. So basically, this is the strongest beers that you get on top, and we limit this by 12. So basically, if you run this, you get the 12 strongest beers, and maybe today is a good day to all try them out all because, yeah, maybe there are reasons for that. I don't know. And all right, and once you've done that, you can go back and just basically clean up. We have the inverse statements for this to first disconnect the bucket, then drop the data sets, and then drop the bucket. All right, so now the question is, what's new? And to some extent, why do we have an additional service here? For that, let's get back to the vision, right? And on this page, basically, we have two services here. We have the query service and we have the analytics service. And they are two. And you're wondering, OK, so both run queries. Why do we have two? And the reason why we have two is that basically both services, as I already alluded to, target very different use cases and very different workloads. So the query service that we see here on the left side is basically optimized for these short queries that we talked about before. So it's optimized to run many short queries that only touch a small amount of data. And the analytics service, on the other hand, it's optimized for fewer queries, but that basically touch a lot more data or all of the data, potentially. And so these different workloads basically require a different architecture, really, to get right. And I think if you have been around databases, I mean, you've probably seen something like this before, right? Also, other database vendors probably have different systems for analytical and transactional workloads, and that is kind of similar. We basically integrate those nicely into one system so that you kind of, first of all, you have a very nice integration between those two systems. Also, we, of course, do something else than other people because we actually support nested data, which most databases are at least, well, they support, but often are not used that way. All right. So we just claimed, okay, so you have different services, and they have different workloads and different architectures, and that is necessary. And so that's one thing to claim that, and another thing to actually find out if that's the case. And so what we did at some point is we did a little experiment to kind of give some proof to that. And so this is the query, and it gets the 10 chattiest users in a specific time frame. So it has a messages data set and an users data set for some new social network that shall not be named. And what it does, it joins the users with their messages, and it restricts the message send time to a certain time interval. Right, and that time interval is variable, so we can just choose what that time interval should be, and then we group that by user ID, and then we order it by the count, and we'll give the top 10 ones. And so that's kind of the similar query that you saw in the previous section, and we use this query on the different services to kind of see how they behave, and what we've seen is basically that we ran these experiments, and if you look at the x-axis here, so we ran this basically for the time frame that was a minute, which was less than 10 tuples or records, and then we ran this for the time frame of an hour, which was less than 500 records, then we ran it for a day, which was less than 5,000, and so on up to the point where we ran it for a time frame of 6 months, which was little less than 600,000 records. And so what you see on the left side here, okay, you see that the blue bar, which is the analytics service, is the big one, and the red bar, which is the query service, is the low one, small one. And that's basically because, I mean, there's a very different architecture in both systems. So while the query service is basically, it runs on a single node. You run the query on a single node. It is parallel. It uses multi-core execution on that node, but it runs on a single node. And basically, the translation, the setup, everything is optimized towards a low latency to get to that goal to actually run this query. This is for basically, for small queries, that is ideal because you want really low latency. On the other side, if you look at what the analytics service does in that time, it takes the query, it usually has more complicated queries, it does an optimization for that, then it does a job scheduling for a cluster, it distributes it on a cluster, and basically by the time that the job is created and the job is distributed, right, the query service has run the query about 10 times or whatever that number is. If, however, you look at the other end of the spectrum, when you touch a lot of data, right? At that case, basically, the investment that we made into running this in parallel and distributing the workload to different nodes pays off. And at that point in time, basically, the blue bar is much lower than the red bar because the red bar now basically has to go through one node, through one machine that has to do all the work. Well, here, basically, we could put the whole cluster to use. So, okay, so I talked about a parallel query processor. I'm not sure if that's kind of, if that is common knowledge to everybody, how that usually works. I've prepared one little example to just give an example of something typical, how that looks, how the parallel query processing works, how these parallel algorithms work. So it's just a very simple example of some generalized aggregation, so which is grouping and aggregation, and you see the query here, it's just a simple counting beer, not even counting, it's just, yeah, it's count star from beers grouped by brewer ID. So it's just how many beers do you have per brewery. And so if you look at this, so assuming now at the bottom you have three partitions that contain some data, right, and it's distributed in whatever way is the way that it came into the system, and you want to aggregate this in a parallel system, what you will do is the first step is whatever you are on the nodes that you are, you will first aggregate each of those partitions that you have locally on the machine that you have to get some local aggregates for those. And so in this case, what you will get is, okay, so for the brewery 2, you will have one beer, and for brewery 3, you have two beers in the first partition, and in the second partition, that's similar, and the third partition, you actually have all three breweries. Then what you will do is you will reshuffle the data that you get based on the brewery ID, the value that you're grouping on, so that basically all the partitions that you want to have are in the right place. So all the brewery 1 records are in the same place, and all the brewery 2 records are in the same place, and all the brewery 3 records are in the same place. And then basically after you repartitioned, you do another one, you do a final aggregation on those repartitioned things, and you get the final result, which is now distributed across the partitions and can then basically be concatenated to return the result to the user. So, and this is just a simple example, and basically similar algorithms are used for joins and for sorting and whatever you want. All right. Now, so then the question is, okay, so how does this work? What's kind of the layout of the services that you're having and the processes that we're running and the nodes that we're running? And so as I have mentioned, it's a separate service, and usually the service will run on separate nodes because that's what we want to do to achieve our workload isolation in our multidimensional scaling. And so we have some great picture that kind of depicts that. So on the left side, you have the data nodes that usually do the many small requests, and on the right side, we have the analytics nodes that serve the few bigger requests. And what's happening is that the data that you have on the left side in the data nodes, the shadowing that's happening using the database change protocol, DCP, that Couchbase uses, it's the same protocol that is also used to feed replicas or to feed indexes. So it's basically there's one protocol that is used to... how do I do that? Sorry? Yeah, well, to distribute it, to send those events around, right? It's basically an event-based protocol that will propagate that information. I think I was looking for propagate, sorry. Yes, and so because that is kind of the protocol that is working anyway, this has a very low impact on the data nodes, so there's no new kind of new replication that's being set up. It's these events are available anyway, and also it provides very low latency, right? I mean, this has been tuned for low latency because this is what replication does, and obviously you don't want to wait for things to replicate. And so you get basically the replication that you get to the analytics service is basically the same latency as you get it to get a replica. Okay. So what actually is in the developer preview, and what actually works today? So I'm getting back to my overview and to the things that I wanted to have. And the first part, the ad hoc queries, is there. You can try that today. The query language is there. You can try it out. You can play with it. You can find out what it does and how you can write queries on your data. The workload isolation is also there in just by the fact that the current DP1 is a separate downloadable thing, and you can basically, it's not integrated with Couchbase Server right now, you will run it next to Couchbase Server, and so you can run it wherever you want and then have an isolated workload. The independent scaling is somewhat there because you can certainly, when you run this separately, it is there. However, it's not at the quality of service that you're used to from Couchbase, where adding another node means setting another checkbox. That's not the level that it's at, so it's more manual than that. You will see that if you try to download and work with it. The common programming and data model is largely there, so basically the HTTP, the APIs are the same between the query service and the analytics service, but the query languages are not quite the same, and so therefore that's why it only gets one of those yellow check marks. The unified management is not there. I just said it's not integrated yet into Couchbase Server, so that is not there. But the fast data synchronization is there. It is a yellow check mark because kind of the quality of service is not where it should be. So if you use Couchbase, you know that failover is not a big problem, so you can just fail over a node and things continue working, and that is unfortunately not the case here yet. All right, so what's in the DP? So as I said before, it's a standalone service. It provides some HTTP APIs. You have the documentation on the web to run C++ queries, to enable query shadowing. It provides very minimal administration. It also provides a query workbench. So if you know the query workbench, you will find this again and can run with that. And it has a very simple installer, which means there is a zip file and a start script that will allow you to run a mini cluster on your node on macOS, Linux, and Windows. So it's all in the same zip file. And so when you start the zip file, a small mini cluster will come up on your node. And what you will see if you look at the processes, that you will have five processes that you see on the right. There's one process which is called a CC driver, and then there are two which are called NC service, and the two which are called NC driver. And I will just quickly explain what those do. So the CC driver is the current provisionary cluster controller. So that kind of controls the cluster. That is the singleton right now, right? Which is for this DP. It contains basically the HTTP API. It contains the C++ compiler and the workbench, and the metadata manager, which is necessary for compilation. The two NC services are kind of the babysitter processes to start up and configure the NC drivers, and the NC drivers are the actual workers that do the work. They contain the parallel data flow engine, and they also contain the storage management and all the disk access. And so when you run this, then basically the internals will look something like this. So basically each NC driver in the sample setup that we do is set up to use two directories that should represent two partitions of the data. And so then basically what you will see here is that the cluster that you start up basically consists of four partitions. We have four partitions of data that you have on disk, and you run basically the degree of parallelism with which you run your queries on this mini cluster that you set up on your machine is four. And so if you want to, you can also configure your own cluster on more machines, but that requires some more manual interaction. And if you want to do that, I think we should discuss that via the forum or later here. All right, that's it. Time for the demo.
All right. So as Theo said, the downloadables are here, available on the Couchbase website. You guys can download from here. So I just download one to my local machine. It's a zip file. Now, this is on my download directory. Now I unzip this, I get all the files, and you enter this CBS directory. And
that's
within
tiny.
That,
can we increase?
Oh, okay, sorry. Is that better? Yeah, okay. So once I'm in that directory.
Can you increase the font size?
Sure, sure. So,
one more.
We have provided some sample scripts for you to start a single machine cluster either on Windows, Mac, or Linux. So I will run that scripts on macOS called start sample cluster. Then the sample cluster has started. If we do JPS, we can find the five processes that Theo mentioned. And once you start a cluster, you can find that the analytics workbench are online now in your local host. And I also have a Couchbase server that is running on my local host. I have the beer sample, a bucket, which everyone here should be familiar with. And now I want to ingest data into Couchbase analytics service. That's the DDLs that Theo just mentioned in his talk. We create a bucket, which is a proxy to the beer sample bucket in Couchbase server. And then we create shadow data sets, one for beer and another for breweries. So once we see connect, the data ingestion started. It's all automatic. And then once we started the data ingestion, we can run queries, for example, here.
Can you just hit command plus plus a few times, Apple plus?
Okay, just make it bigger.
Okay.
Just make it bigger, like a couple of...
All right.
That looks good.
All right, sorry. So if we do select count, we can get all the number of beers. And then if we do a select count over breweries, we get the number of breweries. And the next one is a join query. I want to join beers with the breweries that produce those beers. So it's a join. It's also mentioned in Teo's talk. And it produced the join results here. Since I limited two, I got two documents here. As you can see, the result format is exactly the same as Nico. And I can also do non-key joins, which is something you cannot do in Nico. Is that here is a self join. I join beer with itself. And I want to find beers with the same name, but different breweries. So this is the join query. And we get those three beers. And they each have different, they have each have two breweries, the same query that Teo mentioned in his talk. And the same join query can be expressed using the join syntax, which is exactly the same as SQL 92, and the same result as the previous query. And this is the grouping, group by aggregation queries that Teo talked about in his talk. And these are the results we get, brewery ID and their number of beers. The next one, this is also mentioned in Teo's talk. We want to scan through breweries, and for each brewery, we want to find the list of beers it produced. This is a correlated subquery, and our query optimizer is able to decorrelate that into a left outer join. So that's the result that we get. We get a list of beers associated with each brewery. And this query is slightly, a little bit more complex. This is the same query that I ran before. And now I wrap that using with clause, define a temporary alias. This is a standard SQL 92 with clause. And then I can run a query through that with defined temporary alias. That provides you the capability of modularizing your queries. And this query is trying to find through all the breweries which produce beers with the name like IPA. And the query runs, and you get the result. The result are JSON documents. OK. And now we get to the next one. We want to see how fast, if I write to Couchbase, how fast the data can be synchronized into analytical service. This is the meta ID, which represents the key in the key value store. And we want to search the document with this key. As we know here, we cannot find anything in analytical service because it's not in Couchbase server. Now I'm going to run a Nico insert query to insert the document with the same key into Couchbase server data nodes. And as you can see here, the document is immediately propagated into Couchbase analytical service. Now, if I delete that document and I rerun that query, it disappears. That means the analytics service is always be able to provide you analytical capabilities over fresh data. Those are the queries that run on my local box. Just to be a little bit more interesting, so here I'm going to also show the query that Ravi demos in his keynote yesterday. This is run on AWS instance with 10 node that running analytical service. In Ravi's, because here we are all engineers, so we can talk about those specific queries. Yesterday, Ravi shows you the graph of GitHub commit trends in terms of language, and for each language, you get a monthly commit trend. So here is the query that Ravi, oh, sorry. Okay, sorry. Yeah, All right, so this is a query that Ravi shows in his demo yesterday, the keynote demo. So we first find the repos use with clause. We wrap this subquery to we get the repos, and then we join the GitHub events with repos. Those events contains, for example, push events or create issues or resolve issues or anything on GitHub. So we join the events with repos and we group by languages and months. So we get the statistics for language and months. And then we run a further group by over that with defined alias on monthly commits. And we group by language and we use a subquery to get monthly trend. So this is a query. This is running on AWS with 10 nodes. And it contains millions of documents, hundreds of millions of documents. So what's the result we get? We get within 3 seconds, we get the monthly trends, and the trend is an array here in the result for each language. For example, for Golang, we get an array, and then for Java, we get another array. And from that result, we render using AngularJS. As you saw yesterday, it has a nice graph there. So that's it for the demo.
Yeah. All right, thank you. All right, so next thing is to point you to the next session, which will have more details on C++, on the language, on its design. And now we're open for questions and answers. Yes, please.
Do you need any sort of special index for this? If you didn't create any indexes,
yes. Well, I think we could use some right now. All that you saw there is not doing indexing. It's on the roadmap, so we will add indexing, but it's in the DP currently. We don't talk about that. Yes.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, I should have repeated the question. So the question was, do you support indexes in the analytics service? This is for the recording, and I said, yeah, you got the response. So right now we don't, but we should. Yes, please.
So if you do. When you do support indexes, will you support the same global secondary indexes that Nickel uses?
Probably not. So I think it's because of the different workloads that we're looking at, right? I mean, because the way that the global secondary index is very nice because basically you have a single hop that you go to, right? You find all of your data, and then you go to the next one. However, if we would like to have in our partition parallel system, right? If we want to have an index and we want to look something up, and we probably run on a lot of data, and you want to use the index, for example, for index join, then it's much better to co-locate actually the index data with the original data. That has two advantages. One of them is they're actually available and local when you want to have a local join. It has the other advantage that it also gives you better guarantees or allows us to give better guarantees for the consistency between the index and the actual data. Make sense? I didn't repeat the question again, sorry. So the question was if you support indexes, will you support the same global secondary indexes that Nickel currently supports?
Will this be a case where you have to pre-configure, pre-create all the indexes, or will the analytics service be able to infer which indexes would best execute the query?
Okay, I'll repeat the query. I'll repeat the question, not the query. So the question was, would this be a case where you need to pre-create the index, or would the analytical service determine the indexes on its own? And I think, so the first part of the answer to the question, I think, is the nice thing about all of those queries is, and the fact that it's parallel, that you can run many queries usefully without indexes, right? But of course, there are cases where indexes are really useful, and I think so far, the automatic creation of indexes is not directly next on the roadmap, but thank you for the suggestion.
So the question is, does the analytics server use the similar hashing techniques as with the regular Couchbase server when you distribute the data set through 24 virtual bucket, that sort of thing?
No. It's similar. It's also hashing the data, but it's not using the same technique of the 1024 vbuckets.
Can you elaborate what kind of technique you use to distribute and partition the data
sets? So right now it is hash partitioning, basically, which is a static hash partitioning that you define on the system for the DP. And we're currently working on how we basically do that more dynamically to be able to resize dynamically.
So the workload where you involve the range query, obviously that's very different than the other type of the conditional query clause, for example, here. So what kind of strategies that you plan to use to support different types of the search criteria in the future, for example?
Well, I mean, okay. So, I mean, the one thing is, okay. We said we're thinking about, okay, repeating the question. So, the point was that, okay. So, not all queries basically, not all queries will just work by scanning what we just did, right? You have to use indexes, and then you need to understand how you use the index to find the data. Is that right? No.
So you're going to be supporting a range index capability, for example.
Yes.
Data partitioning or the data distribution would still be hash-based, basically. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Thank you. That's my question.
But the range queries will be supported by having a local index on a partition, and therefore basically you will use the regular B-tree to do the range scans.
So essentially, at the very end, there will always be a scatter and gather operations, if you will.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Thanks. Yes, exactly. Yes. Sorry. Yeah, you first.
Just wondering if you can point out some of the notable differences between NICL and SQL++. I know there's a session right after this that'll get into the gritty details, but like high level.
We could do that, or it's in the documentation on the website. So there we have a list of that.
So
and it you will see there. Okay.
So I actually prepared for this question. Here are the differences. Mm-hmm. So we basically relax the use keys and on keys restrictions. So basically, NICL has those restrictions. It prevents you to run some expensive queries to disrupt your operational workload. But here, you really can run any general things. So that's what we have. But eventually, we might support those when we do GA.
Yes, please. So the question is, we mentioned the local aggregation in the example that we did for the aggregate query, and the question was, where does that happen? Does it happen in the analytic server or in the data node, in the Couchbase server? And it happens in the analytic server. So basically what's happening is that really the analytic server will get a complete replica, a complete shadow of the data that's in the in Couchbase server in the data nodes, and then all of the queries that you're running will run on that shadowed data. Sorry?
Such as Durate, which is a real-time analytics tool as well, and also P-Node.
Droid, right? It's Droid. Are you saying Droid?
Droid and P-Node. So I can't give you the precise question on that because, I mean, we did some performance comparisons, but we did not compare against those two systems. We did some comparisons against Hive, against some commercial relational database systems. And our comparison, the results are usually comparable with commercial relational database systems. And so, yeah, that's kind of the very high level answer that I can give here. It's, yeah.
Can you follow that up with kind of the size of the data sets you were comparing? Or?
We wrote a paper about that. But,
yeah, the answer is that data sets are about four to five times.
Yes, but
for the data set size we compared are 4 to 5 times of the overall RAM size across the cluster.
That was
curious, as we're talking about data storage here in the shadow data sets, if you add a remove node, do you need to recreate those shadow buckets, or are they, will they be able to take advantage of new nodes appearing in the cluster?
So which ones are we adding right now?
So say, let's imagine you add some new analytics nodes to an existing cluster. Do you need to recreate the shadow buckets, or will they automatically accommodate?
Okay, so I'll repeat the question. So if I create a new, if I add a new node, a new analytics node to the cluster, do I need to recreate the shadows, or will they just grow? And the answer for the DP right now is you will have to recreate them. So that's the current answer. And the answer for GA or in that time range should be you shouldn't have to do that. So basically, we want to be basically behave like a proper Couchbase node, but right now we don't. If you were first, or I didn't? Yeah, okay.
He first.
How's the performance comparison? Like, you load data in Spark and Spark RDD versus this approach?
I don't know. Did you try?
We didn't have the comparison yet. But the idea is if you load into RDD, you need to get a schema out from your data. But here is native JSON, and you don't need to do schema inference or any flattening.
Yes.
Does the analytics piece play well with a sync gateway, or are there still limitations there like there are for Nickel and modifying?
I think usually probably our quality of service probably worse than Nickel's at this point in time.
All right.
Yes.
I assume that's on the roadmap?
Yes, but I think, you know.
Yeah.
We had a number of other interesting things that are also on the roadmap, which is just, I wouldn't wait for it necessarily right now. So,
right.
Yes. Yes, please.
When doing shadowing, can I restrict data, say, by document type?
Yes. Yes. Basically, you can have a filter. You can have an arbitrary predicate there to filter the data for the shadow. Yes. Sorry, I didn't repeat the question. The question was, can you filter data when you create a shadow data set? And the answer is yes, you can with just a filter predicate. Yes.
So, in theory, it should work fairly well with sync gateway buckets because the main problem is that you can't modify, with Nickel, you can't modify a sync gateway bucket because there's a bunch of metadata that needs to be maintained.
Yeah. So, usually our quality of service is probably worse than Nickel's, but I mean, yes. So the statement applies, but yeah. Thank you. So the question again was about sync gateway and the support for sync gateway. How this works together with sync gateway and if it has kind of the same outages as Nickel has, and it does. I think we're done. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for the questions.